Audible Inc. presents Measure What Matters. Online tools for understanding customers, social media, engagement, and key relationships. Written by Katie Delahaye Paine. William T. Perlberg, editor. Narrated by Vanessa Hart. Foreword. Now here is a book that is far more than its predecessor. In Measure What Matters, author Katie Delahaye Paine and editor William T. Perlberg revitalize rather than merely revise the curriculum of the University of Measurement as originally presented in Measuring Public Relationships. Much of that original work is here, both the theory and the nitty-gritty of measurement, especially the measurement of relationships. What is new is an emphasis on social media in a business context. Readers will still appreciate the appendix of resources that include books on research and questionnaire items measuring qualities and types of relationships. We still benefit from Katie's rich experience, brilliantly written antidotes, all. Her sidebars of case studies, such as the campaign for SeaWorld that illustrates the role of social media in reaching key influencers, helps bring home the solid principles on which this book is based. The figures, too, help confirm the assertions in the text. The writing here, as previously, is cogent and transparent. Katie makes the arcane world of measurement both understandable and interesting. In other words, readers not only will get it, they'll want to get into it, into the myriad decisions that must be made even before a project is evaluated. The intriguing subheads contribute to the excitement of what has been, for many people, a dull subject. Who wouldn't want to read more when confronted with, if you have no budget at all, you're not in control and never have been, or BS is more damaging than lies? Yes, Katie is clever, and she's also wise. Take, for just one example, the section headed, A Word on Measuring ROI. Given all the strum and drang that typically accompany this concept, we especially appreciated the provision of 5 ways to determine the return, approaches that extend well beyond sales or revenue to include, for example, social capital. She also takes care to explain how to come up with the resources necessary to conduct such evaluation, a discussion that characterized the earlier text as well. One difference here, though, as reflected in the title of the new book, is the emphasis on measurement as a business tool. This shift is consistent with today's aspiration and inclusion of public relations people in the C-suite. The organization of this text, by stakeholders, remains appropriate. After all, relationships with different groups of publics remain the raison d'etre of public relations. Along the way, Katie writes with confidence and candor. As a result, she helps create the very kind of relationship with readers that she urges them to measure with their publics, a relationship born of trust. For just one example, how many professional communicators do you know, especially among those who earn a living doing research, who remind you that less can be more when conducting a survey? As Katie puts it, you can probably get most of the information you need from talking to 250 people. So don't get talked into surveying thousands if you don't really need to. Good advice, but rare in a world where commercial firms may charge by the numbers, and thus appropriate to retain in the new version of the book. Katie goes on to explain that it's possible to survey a mere 500 people and get a representative sample of the whole population of the United States. The book speaks to novices and veterans of the world of measurement. It ends with a glossary of relevant terms, from the controversial, such as AVEs, to the more straightforward, such as trend analysis. Throughout, Katie emphasizes the importance of measuring relationships created and nurtured via digital media. In this way alone, she sets her book apart from many others. Those that focus on media hits, for example, or strategic messaging. She clearly differentiates among measuring outputs, outtakes, and outcomes. She proceeds from one strategic public to another, not assuming that one system of measurement fits all. So she describes how to measure relationships with the community, opinion leaders, employees, members, volunteers, investors, partners, the media, and sales reps. She teases out what is unique about evaluating relationships in times of crisis and through blogs and other new media. She explains how to plan and budget. Katie does all this through both words and numbers, exactly as a competent research report would be prepared. She infuses this new look at measurement with her solid grasp of all social media. By emphasizing measurement as a tool for business people rather than public relations people alone, she extends the scope of measure what matters. Scope may be inadequate here. Perhaps we should characterize the reach of this guide to measurement as an enormous sweep. In any case, Katie Paine has walked the walk that so many of our colleagues merely talk about. The typical book on research, like too many researchers, overpromises and underdelivers. Readers anxious to know more and to do better approach these books with optimism, but leave in frustration at the level of the text or its inadequate explication. At the very least, their minds feel chloroformed by the language. By contrast, here we have a book that is a vivid, engaging, accessible, and wise reflection of what Katie does and all she knows. It's nifty stuff, and well worth knowing. Larissa A. Grunig, James E. Grunig, Professors Emeriti, Department of Communication, University of Maryland. Preface. We talk about the quality of product and service. What about the quality of our relationships, and the quality of our communications, and the quality of our promises to each other? Max Dupree. I am amazed at the continuing significance of the quotation above. What about the quality of our relationships? It is an essential and perennial question that lies at the heart of our social and business lives. Many of the examples of corporate relationships that I used in my book, Measuring Public Relationships, are included in this new book as well. And all of them ring just as true today as they did then. Now, just as then, measuring what matters means measuring relationships. The difference is, of course, that everything in our world has changed. In just a few short years, the social media phenomenon has radically shifted our political, social, and especially corporate landscape. Traditional media outlets are closing daily. Marketing is moving dollars out of traditional advertising and into social media strategies at a breakneck pace. And the illusion of control that corporate communications once thought it had over its messages and stakeholders has vanished forever in a sea of tweets, updates, and blog posts. Success, timing, media, and PR have all been redefined by social media. Success can no longer be measured in terms of reach or frequency, since neither is particularly easy to determine in this new space. Success must now be defined in terms of outcomes. What do you want your program to do for the organization? Timing has been changed forever by the demise of deadlines. It used to be that you had at least until 5 p.m. to make the evening news with a comment. Now, if that comment isn't posted on Twitter within an hour or so, people will begin to accuse you of ducking the issue. In the social media world, 2 or 3 hours may be all you have to get your story straight. The definitions and boundaries between different forms of media are another moving target. It used to be that National Public Radio was radio. But now that more and more people are getting their news from the NPR website, that site must be constantly fed with music, pictures, and video. So do you classify that as radio or as online news? Hint, it's the latter. And when did we ever think of local TV stations as a place for still photographs? But today they are. During any major weather crisis, visitors to TV websites are invited to post their storm pictures for the world to see. In some ways, we are all now photojournalists. The notion that a PR person is someone who has to deal only with the press is just as antiquated. A good PR person is focused on his or her relationships, be they with the local media, national bloggers, employees, or community organizers. And so we are back to the big point here, relationships. All transactions conducted today, from buying a printer to donating to a cause to protesting a local initiative, are still, and I would argue always will be, driven by relationships. The difference is that a decade ago we talked primarily about relationships between corporations and their stakeholders. Now the relationship is just as likely to be between two individuals on your Facebook page. Actually, make that millions of individuals on millions of Facebook pages. And without knowing how to measure those millions of relationships, you are more likely than ever to be lost in a sea of data, words, and reactions. Over more than two decades, I've measured communications programs for hundreds of organizations. I've figured out how to measure success in many, many shapes and forms. Public relations, media relations, employee communications, events, sponsorships, trade shows, and academia. And I can honestly say that no one has brought me a communications program that I could not develop measurement for. I actually started measuring social media back in 1996, when it was known as consumer-generated media. And my company was tracking the sentiment of newsgroup mentions regarding computer printers. Through all those years and all those programs, the one common denominator has been relationships. Lots of different types of relationships with lots of different constituencies. I am convinced that the key to understanding corporate reputation is measuring the relationships that it is based on. Whether you work for a Fortune 500 international powerhouse or run a local nonprofit, you share a common interest in the relationships you have with your constituencies. Building, managing, and measuring those relationships are fundamental to your success and the success of your organization. As our world has become more electronic and in many ways less personal, the importance of those relationships has increased. Our new and efficient communication technologies make relationships easier to initiate, but sometimes operate to the detriment of relationships, both interpersonal and organizational. And for some organizations, understanding how to measure and better manage their relationships is becoming a matter of survival. If you can measure your relationships, you can compare them, and so improve your communications effectiveness and overall performance. This book has grown from my experience in designing and implementing measurement systems. It is based on hundreds of actual stories about how organizations have used measurement to improve their reputations, strengthen their bottom lines, and improve efficiencies all around. The following pages provide you with tools, tips, techniques, and experiences that illustrate how to measure your success, and specifically, the success of your relationships. This is a book that all professional communicators can use, whether they work for Procter & Gamble or for a small local nonprofit, to improve their work and the organizations they work for. Here's wishing you nearly immeasurable amounts of success. Katie Delahaye Paine. Part 1. Not Your Father's Ruler. Chapter 1. You can now measure everything, but you won't survive without the metrics that matter to your business. What is wanted is not the will to believe, but the will to find out, which is the exact opposite. Bertrand Russell. Until recently, the attitude toward measurement in business has been, it's too expensive and too complicated, and really only applicable for major corporations. In the past decade, however, a confluence of circumstances has pushed measurement and metrics onto the priority lists of business people everywhere. First, there was the internet explosion. The internet, and specifically social media, has been adopted by businesses worldwide in record-breaking time. It took 89 years for the telephone to reach the level of household penetration that Facebook reached in just 5. As consumers increasingly research and purchase goods online, their behaviors, thoughts, and opinions have become easier to track and measure. At the same time, the proliferation of listening, analysis, and reporting tools has made such metrics affordable and accessible to every organization, from nonprofits to go-fast internet startups. Then there is the current global recession. In these hard times, most every business is taking a hard look at what strategies, programs, and communications are working and not working. Today, if you're in business and want to survive, you will need to continuously measure and improve your processes and programs. Whether or not you are measuring, your competition very likely is, and as a result, probably knows more about your business than you do. This book will do much more than just teach you how to measure. It will teach you how to measure what you need to make the decisions that are crucial to your business. It used to be that he or she with the most data wins, but today nothing is cheaper and easier to come by than data, especially useless data. It's having the right data that counts. While every program is different, all organizations have a core set of key publics with whom they need to build relationships, collectively known as the stakeholders. These include, among others, the media, employees, customers, distributors or sales force, the local community, industry influencers, financial analysts, and elected officials. Each stakeholder group requires slightly different measurement tools and slightly different metrics. That's why this book is organized around the stakeholders, each with its own chapter and its own procedures and advice. This book shows you how to measure business relationships with just about any key public that your job involves. Social media isn't about media, it's about the community in which you do business. Most of what I advocate in this book wouldn't be possible or necessary without social media. We talk about social media as a shiny new object, as if it's some sort of a new toy for business. In fact, social media has changed everything important to your business, from marketing and sales to employee and financial management. The social media revolution has forced all of us to rethink how we approach business, our marketplaces, and our customers. Today, customers talk to and trust each other more than they do companies. They choose how they spend their time and money based on recommendations from people with similar tastes and profiles. They trust, and therefore prefer to do business with, companies that are open, honest, and authentic. Companies with which they have good relationships are more likely to be forgiven when they make a mistake. Thus, companies that listen carefully to their customers and respond to their needs will survive and prosper. Those who don't will be gone. In order to succeed in this new era of easy and frequent conversations, it is critical that you continuously listen to and evaluate what your market is saying about you. Companies that do can promote themselves more efficiently, innovate more effectively, and operate more profitably. Measurement is so much more than counting. Before we get into the how-tos of measurement, we need to be clear on our definitions. Everyone in business already has some form of accounting in place. All business owners know how to count inventory, the number of ads they place, or the number of stories in which they are mentioned. They count their customers, their sales, and generally count their profits. But counting is very different from measurement. Counting just adds things up and gets a total. Measurement takes those totals, analyzes what they mean, and uses that meaning to improve business practices. Measurement of your processes and results, where you spend your time and money, and what you get out of it, provides the data necessary to make sound decisions. It helps you set priorities, allocate resources, and make choices. Without it, hunches and gut feelings prevail. Without it, mistakes get made, and no one learns from them. What really matters to your business? Only a handful of businesses, those that prosper, grow, and continuously improve, measure what matters. Most organizations, when asked what really matters to their business, would probably say, my customers, or my employees. And they'd be partially correct. But it's not the number of customers and employees that matter. It's the relationships that your organization has with them that matters. Good relationships lead to profits. With good relationships, prospects become customers, and customers become loyal advocates for your company. Thanks to good relationships, employees stay, learn, grow, and contribute to their organizations. Poor relationships result in more expensive operations, fewer sales, less customer loyalty, more churn, higher legal fees, higher turnover rates, more expensive recruiting costs, and ultimately, disadvantage in the marketplace. In public relations, if you establish good relationships with reporters, bloggers, editors, and other key influencers, they'll trust your word, cut you slack in a crisis, and turn to you for your thoughts and opinions. A lack of good relationships with the media leads to crisis escalating, omission from key stories, and less inclusion of your point of view in stories. So what really matters is your relationships and the aggregated outcome of those relationships, your reputation. Today, if you're not measuring the health of your relationships, you won't be in business for very long. This book tells you how to measure those relationships and what to do with the data once you have it. Why measure at all? When budgets are flush, there's a popular misconception that it doesn't much matter how you measure results, as long as there's a perfunctory number that shows up for your department every so often. But times aren't always flush, and the bean counters and stakeholders are getting more demanding. Even when profits are rising, measurement saves time and money. The spectacular proliferation of social media, from Twitter to Facebook to YouTube and beyond, means the average business person is faced with a bewildering array of opportunities and obstacles. It's a new and rapidly changing world out there, and the most productive way to run your business is not obvious. The prudent and productive approach is to measure the results of all your efforts in a consistent manner, and compare the results against a clearly articulated and predefined set of goals. When I entered the field of corporate communications, it was by way of journalism, and I had little practical knowledge of communications tactics and strategies. So I asked a lot of questions, such as, where do we get the most bang for the buck? And which strategy results in the cheapest cost per message communicated? At the time, no one had the answers at their fingertips. So I developed systems to get the data. And for more than two decades, I have been refining those systems and developing new ones. You will read about them in detail in the following chapters. Along the way, I learned that measuring your success is not just another buzzword that follows Six Sigma, TQM, and paradigm shifts. It's a key strategic tool that helps you better manage your resources, your department, and your career. No matter what type or size of organization you are in, there are half a dozen advantages to setting up a measurement program. Here they are. Data-driven decision-making saves time and money. Making decisions based on the data saves time and boosts your credibility. When faced with tough decisions, you'll seldom find boards of directors or CEOs relying on hunches or gut instinct. Chances are any decisions made at the highest levels will be made following extensive research. So why should other business decisions be any different? How credible would your CFO be if he got up in front of the board and said, I know we're making money because I see the checks coming in? Just as the CFO relies on accounting data to give advice and make recommendations on financial issues, you need other data to decide where, when, and how to allocate resources in other departments, including HR, marketing, public affairs, communications, and sales support. It helps allocate budget and staff. I once used a competitive media analysis to indicate the need for PR staff for a major semiconductor company. We analyzed this client's presence in key media and compared it to that of three competitors to determine who was earning the greatest share of ink. As it happened, over a two-year period, there was very little difference between the competitors, with the four organizations equally matched in coverage each month. But at a certain point, the client's results took a dive. All of a sudden, its share of ink in the key trade media dropped to about 2%. I presented the results and asked the audience, which included several managers, what had happened. The answer was, that was when we reorganized and eliminated our PR effort. I replied by demonstrating that in the months following the reorganization, the market had had about 9 times more opportunities to see news about the competition's products than their own. That seemed to do the trick. The last time I was in touch, the PR staff had grown to about 10 people, and their budget was increasing every year. Gain a better understanding of the competition. Your business or organization is always competing for something. Sales, donations, search ranking results, share of conversations, share of wallet, or share of voice. So you need to know how you stack up against your peers and rivals. Measurement gives you insight into competitive strengths and weaknesses. Strategic planning. Deciding how to best allocate resources is arguably the most important responsibility of any manager. But without data, you are forced to rely on gut instinct. And as accurate as your gut may be, it doesn't translate very well into numbers. What you need is data. Data you can rely on to guide your decisions and to improve your programs. Measurement gets everyone to agree on a desired outcome. You can't decide what form your measurement program is going to take without an agreed-upon set of goals. This alone may be the best reason to start measuring. Putting everyone in a room and getting agreement on what a program is designed to achieve eliminates countless hours of blaming and bickering later if the project doesn't work. This is especially true with social media. Too often people will complain that marketing dollars spent on social media are unmeasurable, when in fact, the real reason metrics don't exist is that no one ever articulated just what the social media program was designed to do. And getting our feet wet in social media is not a measurable goal, unless you're a duck. Measurement reveals strengths and weaknesses. Measurement isn't something you should do because you're forced to. It should be approached as an essential strategic tool to more effectively run your business. Deciding how to allocate the necessary resources and staff is easier if you know exactly what works and what doesn't, especially when it comes to social media. One of my first experiences with measurement was at Lotus Development, now IBM Software. I was nearing the end of my first year there, and I wanted to determine what had worked and what hadn't. My primary role was to ensure the successful communication of key messages to the target audience. So we gathered 2,400 or so articles that mentioned Lotus during the previous year and analyzed each one to determine whether it left a reader more or less likely to purchase Lotus software and whether it contained one or more of the key messages our company was trying to communicate about itself. To do the analysis, I hired 20-something college students who were in the market for software. I gave them careful instructions on how to read and analyze each article to determine if it left them more or less likely to buy Lotus software. The results were very revealing. The $350,000 launch, with a major cocktail party, of a word processing product generated plenty of coverage, but very few of those articles contained our key messages. In fact, a $15,000 press tour was much more effective at getting key messages to our target audiences. The metric we used to measure success was cost per message communicated, CPMC. And the press tour delivered a CPMC of 0.02 cents compared to the party's CPMC of $1.50. See figure 1.1. Based on this data, we immediately cut the planned $150,000 party out of the next product launch plan. Even more revealing was our success in penetrating new markets. We were targeting software buyers with a product that required us to reach an entirely new audience that relied upon a distinct group of industry trade magazines. When we analyzed the results, we realized that this new group of journalists had not responded well to our pitch. And in fact, their stories were only half as likely to contain key messages as was typical. I called a few of these journalists and tracked down the source of their problem, which turned out to be a member of my staff who wasn't responding in a timely manner. Through proper coaching, I was ultimately able to repair the relationship. Another example involves a client who had us compare the results of a press tour with those of a press conference to determine which was more effective. The results varied little in terms of quantity of coverage. In terms of quality, however, the press tour received nearly twice as much positive press and communicated almost twice as many messages, all for a fraction of the cost of the press conference. Here's an example from the nonprofit world. In 2009, my company compared two programs undertaken by the USO. In one, newly elected President Obama stuffed care packages on the White House lawn. And in another, the Colbert Report visited Baghdad. Our metrics showed that the Colbert event generated about 10 times more publicity, but both events generated almost identical amounts of online donations and at vastly different costs. The Obama event wasn't nearly as expensive or as interesting to the media, but it sent out a very effective message to the USO's mailing list. If you can't be there to support the USO in person, donate online. Measurement gives you reasons to say no. All too often, making decisions based on gut feeling rather than data leads to overworked staff with unclear priorities. If and when you are presented with demands that seem ill-timed, rushed, or just plain unwise, there is simply no good argument with which to say no. However, if you have data on the results of previous programs, you frequently gain the leverage you need to turn down requests that will be a waste of time or resources. One of my clients took saying no to an entirely new level. At the time, she was a lowly researcher, but each month she'd look at her report and highlight all the worst performing programs. She'd take the data to her boss and point out the failures. She'd then move budget and resources out of the failing programs and redirect them to those that were working. In short order, the department was operating so effectively that she was promoted to vice president. Dispelling the myths of measurement. So if measurement is all that valuable and important, why isn't everyone already doing it? There are a number of bona fide reasons. Lack of knowledge, lack of time, lack of a clear strategy. But most of the so-called reasons people give stem from a few commonly held myths about measurement. Myth number one, measurement equals punishment. Measurement is too often seen as a way to check up on people or a department, and thus is too often used to justify the existence of a program or budget. People shy away from accountability, fearing that it will reveal flaws and weaknesses in the organization. However, in two decades in this business, I have never seen anyone punished for being more accountable. No one I've worked with has ever been punished for showing how to make a program more efficient, or for having clear and quantifiable ways to figure out what works or what doesn't. In fact, most people who institute measurement programs find that they get more promotions, bigger raises, and increased budgets because of their ability to identify strengths and weaknesses and allocate resources more intelligently. A corollary to the measurement equals punishment myth is, I'm afraid I'll get bad news. Too many people are afraid of projects being canceled because they aren't working, or that they will hear unpleasant things from the stakeholders. The truth is, if something isn't working, it's wasting money and resources. So why would you want to continue it? And if people are saying bad things about your organization, they'll keep on saying them anyway, even if you're not listening and participating in the conversation. Myth number two. Measurement will only create more work for me. In the overall scheme of things, measurement seems to many of us just one more thing in a long list of high-priority items. Too often it gets dropped to the bottom of the list because it seems like too much work. The reality is that once a measurement system is in place, it actually makes everything else much easier. Data at your fingertips helps you to better direct the resources you have, ensuring that they are having maximum impact. Data at your disposal means less time debating the merits of one tactic over another. Gut feelings can always be second-guessed, but data is much harder to argue with. Myth number three. Measurement is expensive. The number one reason that people give for not measuring is that they can't afford it. The truth is, you can't afford not to measure. Without measurement, you have no way of knowing if you are spending your budget effectively. A measurement system frequently pays for itself because it inevitably leads to increased efficiency. One international client of ours called its PR agencies together and showed them the results of our $10,000 benchmark study of their PR. Based on those results, the agencies were given concise new objectives for directing specific messages to specific audiences. 6 months later, communication of the company's key messages had risen by 245%, and sales had increased in each country that implemented the program. Think of that. A tool that could more than double the exposure of key messages to your target audience and increase sales, all for less than $10,000. Myth number four. You can't measure the ROI, so why bother? ROI is an accounting term that means return on investment. To calculate the ROI of any project, you take the total amount of money saved or brought in and subtract from it the total budget amount invested, then divide it by the cost of investment. That's the net return, and it is typically a measure of money saved, costs avoided, or revenue brought in. There are some programs for which establishing a reliable ROI figure is not an easy task, but it is generally doable. For example, suppose you institute a new communications effort designed to increase trust in the organization, and you spend $50,000 on social media, public relations efforts, and community outreach. Now, suppose that, as a result, the next time you go before the city council for a zoning board variance, your request breezes through in one meeting. You've probably saved that $50,000 in legal fees alone. Or suppose that you have to recall a product and your sales rebound in 3 months instead of 12. Again, the net gains far outweigh the cost of your outreach program. Just because something isn't easy to measure, it's no reason not to measure it. Too often the people who are screaming loudest about not being able to demonstrate the ROI of their programs are those who simply don't want to try anything new. They are just using ROI as an excuse to say no. Myth number five. Measurement is strictly quantitative. Another myth claims that measurement primarily concerns quantifiable entities such as sales, leads, conversions, mentions, friends or followers. The reality, however, is that the only type of measurement system that works combines both qualitative and quantitative data. If all you look at are sales, and not the relationships your organization has with its publics, you'll never be able to accurately understand why those sales go up or down. To really understand your successes and failures, you need to measure what I call revenutionships. Both the revenue you bring as well as the relationships and reputation that you build with your publics. Myth number 6. Measurement is something you do when a program is over. Measurement is seen too frequently as an afterthought, a tool to gauge the efficiency of a program you have already completed. On the contrary, in order to be maximally effective, measurement should be in place at the start of a program. Myth number 7. I know what's happening. I don't need research. I hear it all the time, and so often from managers who are generally quite effective, but who could be so much more effective if they only understood the true value of measurement. Measurement provides the context and the rationale behind changes in your reputation, your relationships, and ultimately your P&L. Everyone has a formal accounting system to track and measure profit and loss. So why the reluctance to establish similar formal systems to track and evaluate other business processes like marketing and communications efforts, relationships, and reputation? Without such systems in place, you will never know why your sales rise and fall, or what you need to do to make them rise faster. Measurement, the great opportunity. Where are most companies in terms of measurement, and where could they be? Despite billions spent on marketing and communications, the percentage of companies who are actually measuring their marketing efforts is shockingly low. Study after study shows that most CEOs don't feel that they have adequate measures in place. And despite, or because, of the rapid growth of data mining, the general consensus is that there's lots of data but very little insight. Part of the reason is that most organizations don't allocate sufficient resources to measurement. The annual Annenberg GAP study of common practices in public relations for 2010 reports that the average corporation spends just 4.5% of its marketing budget on evaluation. Another recent study found that 79% of organizations aren't measuring the ROI of their social media efforts at all. In general, those organizations that measure do better than those that don't. Years of studies have shown that one of the key ingredients of excellence is the ability to measure what matters. All the best performers on most of the top 100 lists are what we call measurement mavens. They invest in metrics and research on a regular basis and use the results to continually improve their operations. Most of the companies on Fortune's most admired list have had some form of formal marketing measurement in place for years. What this translates into for most businesses is a great opportunity. As long as the competition isn't measuring, you have a huge competitive advantage. You can listen to your customers and theirs and act on the issues and opportunities of your marketplace, all while your competition continues to operate in the dark. You'll respond faster. Your relationships with your employees and customers will be better, and your reputation will be stronger. The results will show in your bottom line. Chapter 2. How to Get Started. All truths are easy to understand once they are discovered. The point is to discover them. Galileo Galilei. If you are new to measurement, it's best to start with baby steps. An annual measurement program can be a sizable undertaking, and if your organization hasn't done one before, it is a daunting process. I highly recommend beginning with a pilot program, either a 3-month benchmark study or a targeted program aimed at a particular launch or event. This relatively painless route will get people addicted to the numbers, and they'll invariably ask for more. A note about measurement and politics. Your measurement program will eventually step on someone's toes. It is inevitable that your data will challenge some traditional wisdom, or put someone's pet project on hold, or at the very least, change internal priorities. Somebody is not going to like it, and they will push back, The good news is that you will be basing your conclusions and recommendations on real data. The facts will be on your side. As long as you have confidence in your data, you're standing on solid ground. Once you've established yourself as a data-driven manager who relies on accurate data, your credibility will soar. And let's emphasize that. Accurate data is the key to both the success of your measurement and to the decisions you base on it. 10 questions every communications professional must be able to answer. Before we get into the specifics of measurement, you will need to have at hand some basic information about your organization. Work through the following 10 questions and do your best to find the answers if you don't know them already. What's most important about this exercise is achieving consensus among the people who will be using and/or contributing to the measurement data you will be collecting. Getting everyone on the same page is an absolute necessity before you can begin to implement a measurement program. Question number one. What are your objectives? While it may seem facile and simplistic to actually put this question on the list, I am amazed at the number of people I've met with who cannot answer it. Or even more frequently, they have objectives that are not measurable. You must start with a thorough understanding of your company's or organization's business objectives. And if they are not written down somewhere, ask your boss. You might have a very interesting conversation. I sometimes help my clients through the process by asking them to shut their eyes and imagine that it is the end of the year, and they are celebrating enormous success. Corks are popping, champagne is flowing, and bonus checks are being passed out to everyone. What is it that they are celebrating? Another way to define your mission is to frame it from the opposite perspective. Suppose your department was wiped out tomorrow. How would the business suffer? Later in this chapter, you will find a detailed step-by-step procedure for working with a team to develop measurable objectives. Question number two. Who are your program's target audiences? This is another question that may be pretty obvious for some companies, but it never hurts to get it in writing. The important thing is to define the audience as specifically as you can, no matter what your business or organization. The answer to this question is not anyone with a pulse. There is always, within any market, a set of customers who are the most profitable, the most valuable. These are the ones you want to target. Question number three. What is important to your audiences? Once you've defined your audiences, you can go about determining what issues matter most to them. What inspires them? What scares them? What are they most passionate about? Where do they go for information? The closer you get to identifying an audience's passions, the closer you are to understanding why they are loyal to your company or brand. Question number four. What motivates them to buy your products? This is perhaps the most salient question for your measurement program. The answer will determine what you measure. You need to connect your actions with the ultimate purchase decision. If you sell a commodity product, and what motivates purchase is price, value, then you need to measure the extent to which this concept is being communicated to your marketplace. However, if you are selling a service, and what motivates purchase is the long-term relationship with the brand and or the salesperson, then you need to be measuring relationships or brand engagement. Question number five. What are your key messages? If you haven't articulated them yet or don't know what they are, do research to figure out what messages will resonate most.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.